Velasquez, and welcome to Future Perfect Tech Shorts. Oh, can the newest BlackBerry save the struggling mobile phone maker, RIM? The company is gambling its survival on the much-delayed BlackBerry 10, hoping to claw its way back into an industry that's overcrowded by Apple, Samsung, and just recently, Windows. Let's find out more from this report.
The BlackBerry experience, redesigned, re-engineered, reinvented. That's the impression BlackBerry maker Research in Motion wants to make during its comeback bid as the company unveils the BlackBerry 10 operating system and the respective handsets that go with it. The latest edition boasts six major features. First, the redesigned BlackBerry World, the storefront where users can access applications, games, and more. The BlackBerry Balance, which helps users separate their private transactions from their work. The BlackBerry Browser features powerful page rendering and built-in sharing to your favorite social networking sites. The camera's time shift mode captures milliseconds before and after your photo so you can create the perfect picture. The revamped BlackBerry keyboard provides an effortless typing experience, and if you tend to mistype certain letters, the keyboard will remember and subtly adjust to make sure you hit the right key. And lastly, the BlackBerry Hub lets you stay in touch with a single swipe. The release is widely seen as a make or break for RIM, which has widely slipped and sunk in the smartphone market it once dominated. Once the major pusher of crackberries, the company now has to make a new mark, and fast, in a market led by Apple, Google, and Windows.
Ah, BlackBerry. I hope people still remember that. Now, with ever-rising fuel prices, motorists are always looking for ways to save on fuel. Now, one oil company is trying to help them do that with their interactive online games, which they claim teaches them to be better and more fuel-efficient drivers. And with us on the show is Vanessa Ejercito. She's the fuel brand's manager for Shell Philippines. Vanessa, thanks very much for coming to the show.
Good evening.
Are you an efficient driver?
Of course I am, because I work for Shell.
Now, when this game itself, or the games that they're actually developed to help people learn how to drive better, how does it work?
Okay, so we launched this Target 1 million. Mm-hmm. It's a campaign to help 1 million drivers to know how to save on fuel and to drive efficiently.
Right.
So it's a series of online games that teaches them how to choose the right fuel, as well as to how to change your driving behaviors.
Okay, so they run off on from a browser?
Yes.
Okay.
They have to go to the website.
And the website is?
www.shell.com.ph/target1million.
All right. So when they start up the game, what are the mechanics? I mean, what are you supposed to accomplish?
Okay, there are a series of games. There are three games right now. We have the Shell Fuel Save Challenge. This is the main game. Mm-hmm. It teaches the player how to save on fuel.
Okay.
Okay.
Is there like a target, how much fuel you're supposed to use up?
Yes. So they have to, the challenge of the game is, they have to bring the car from the garage to the Shell station without running out of gas.
Is this in the virtual world?
Within the time, yes.
Is this in the virtual world?
Yes.
The online game, right?
Yes, it's
online. So bring it from the garage to the gas station.
To the gas station without running out of gas.
Okay.
And not running out of time.
Not running. So there's a time limit. You're given a limited amount of fuel.
Yeah, yes.
Okay. So for example, how much fuel are you given in the game?
It doesn't say.
It doesn't say? But how much time? How much time
you have about 100 seconds.
100 seconds. So just like about, do the math, about a minute and 40 seconds. All right. So 100 seconds to complete the game. So does this actually attract, adults to play the game?
Yes, because it's different from having a classroom type of learning, you know. So it's an online game. You know, most people are now in front of the computers. And you injected some fun and as well in the learning process.
Right. And what are the techniques that you would probably pick up from playing this game?
Okay, so first in the setting up in the garage.
Okay.
So you have to check like the trunk, is it full? Because if it's full, it weighs down the car.
Okay.
So
this is
a
virtual car, huh?
Yes.
And then you can open the trunk and check what the contents are.
It prompts you which to check.
Okay.
So you have to check the car, the trunk.
Check the trunk.
So should only leave those safety items.
Are there any virtual objects in the trunk? Like, for example, I've got to throw out my golf bag. Or I'll throw out, these old shoes.
Yes. So that's another game, the bootloader game.
Ah, okay.
So it teaches you what to remove from the trunk.
From the trunk. Mm-hmm. So the unnecessary weight that
you
have
to
get rid of.
It.
Okay, that's also one game.
Yes.
And
the third one is the fuel tank focus.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a pop quiz. So it teaches you on fuel economy. So it asks specifically on your driving behavior, mm-hmm. those things.
All right. Now, who designed all of these games?
It's a global campaign.
Uh-huh.
So it's the...
So this is about parent company?
Yes.
The head company that designed it?
And it was launched in about 20 countries
mm-hmm.
around the world. So the target, we need to reach the target 1 million.
All right. What has been the reception so far, the feedback to the games?
So far, the motorists are happy and they're learning in a different way.
Uh-huh.
So, and it's fun and exciting.
Learning in a different way.
Yeah.
And the end result should be that they'll learn how the techniques are.
Yeah. It teaches them how to use the right fuel and how to drive properly.
The right fuel?
Yeah.
I mean, in the game itself, I'm wondering, in a virtual world, when you're driving a car, does it also give you an opportunity, say, this is a manual transmission or automatic transmission? I mean, what does it do? Are there differences in the cars that they can use?
In the game, no. Just one.
Just one?
Yeah,
so it's just
one.
Parang automatic transmission lang.
Mm-hmm. Okay. There's just one type of car.
One type of car?
Yeah.
Okay. I was hoping maybe because they could add, maybe in the future, my suggestion to the game developers is to add the different maybe category of vehicles, right?
Yeah.
That they could add maybe.
So we're still coming out with two more games within the year.
Yeah.
So hopefully we can include that one.
Target 1 million. So in fact, you can count how many people have gone online to play the game.
Yes.
Yes.
Because the website itself can monitor the registration as well as their score in the game.
Fantastic. Yeah. Have you played the game yourself?
Yes.
What was your score?
I think it's about 1,000. I can't remember.
And
I made it on the Fuel Save Challenge.
You made it on the Fuel Save Challenge. And the bootloader thing? You
yes.
also play that?
Yeah.
Okay. So the high score there will be registered as well or posted as well. So is there a running count for, say, how many people have played a game in the Philippines? Or is this a worldwide total that you're talking about? 1 million?
It's a worldwide
total. Mm-hmm. So far, what's the number that has been reached?
Because it's constantly moving, I can't say right now. But
the last time you checked?
Yeah, for last time, Shell Philippines is number one globally in terms of the number of registrants.
Mm, okay, so they just go anytime to the website and play the game. It's more for, of course, educational than for anything. Wala naman reward dyan, di ba?
No, if we do mall activations, booths, there we do giveaways, prizes.
So for example, ikaw yung high score at this particular
beat
time,
the score.
Then you get something, right? Mm. Oh, fantastic. Well, ako, I had my own suggestions. Hopefully, they'll be incorporated into your game. Diba? Next time, merong maneho ka ng
different types
of vehicles, diba? Yung iba doon, dadaan ng checkpoint sa Timonan, kunwari, di ba? Okay, never mind that. That's another game. That's bulletproofing your car.
Yes.
Yeah. All right. Vanessa Ejercito from Shell Philippines. Thanks very much for dropping by.
Thank you. Hope to see you again.
Coming up next, a project aimed at enticing high schoolers to take up science and technology degrees when Future Perfect returns. Welcome back to Future Perfect Tech Shorts. A contest designed to promote interest in science and technology among high school students hopes to address the shortage of engineers in the Philippines by getting them to pursue engineering degrees and scholarships. A project to class invites third-year students from 18 public high schools in Metro Manila to explore the energy potential from fruits, plants, and trees. The project is organized by ISEC, a global nonprofit student organization, and the Philippine Development Foundation, or PhilDev, a U.S.-based group promoting science and technology innovation. And joining us on the show is Rita Galvez. She's the head of Project to Class. And believe it or not, Justin Bieber. No, that's not Justin Bieber. That's Matt Damiao. He's the international mentor of Project to Class. Matt and Rita, thanks very much, both of you, for coming to the show. Sure. Now, Project to Class, of course, do you know what to class means?
Discovering.
That's right. Well, Tagalog lessons later. Now, to class obviously is meant to discover new ways or new sources of energy. How did the project begin, Rita?
So, Isaac UP Delaman wanted to address the issue of the lack of scientists and engineers in the country. So, what we did was we created Project to Class, as what he said, to entice.
So, it's an Isaac conceptualized project.
Yes. Isaac UP Delaman conceptualized this project, and as I said, we just really wanted to address that issue of the lack of scientists and engineers in the country.
Okay, but you know, this is the thing, when I was in UP and I could always see Isaac, I was always thinking, you know, this is more like a group for business people, for the economics and business students, but you're now talking more about engineering.
Yes.
Right? So, imagine a shift na yung focus ngayon na Isaac, to that field. All right, now, Project to Class, is looking for students from 18 public high schools.
Yes.
Right. And your role now, Matt, as an international mentor, is to guide these students from the public high schools?
Yeah. Our work as a mentor is to provide these students with, to work as consultants, to provide expertise and background knowledge in our majors, which are science and engineering majors, and try to help the students to take their original idea and make a real working prototype that can help in the theme of the project, which is the future of energy.
Right. And how did you become an international mentor? I mean, for yourself, personally, what is your interest or stake in this?
I was actually working in Isaac also in Brazil, which I came from Brazil.
Okay.
And Isaac has these exchange programs, which aims to they have exchange programs that provide professional development experiences and also volunteer work. Mm-hmm. And one of the projects that I saw that was available was Project to Class. So then I decided that it would be like a good experience for me and for my career in the future. So
because you're taking up
electrical engineering.
Electrical engineering. Yeah. So you have you can practically say that you have a little bit more experience than these high school students,
for sure,
right?
Yeah.
So in a way, helping to identify which projects these high school students could feasibly turn out into some real life application, right? So have you actually selected students now from the high schools?
Yes, so we started out with more than 75 submissions for our local high school competition.
Okay.
So the local high school competition is where we ask the different teams from the different schools to submit project proposals with the theme the future of energy, and we garnered around more than 75 submissions, and we selected the top two for every high school.
So there are only 18 participating public high schools, but there are 75 out from the 18 already. 75 submissions.
Yes.
So each school could submit more than one.
Yes.
Obviously, right? All right, and then we were saying you can look for alternative sources of energy from plants, from fruits, from trees. I was looking through the list, and I was so impressed. Have you eaten durian, Matt?
No, I haven't eaten, but there's a project.
But you know the smell, right? You know the smell, right? So even from the smell alone, you know it can power a rocket from here to the moon, right? Right. So they can actually, you're looking at getting biofuel from, what is it, marang?
Yes.
Durian?
Mango.
Mangoes? I was kind of impressed, yeah. Did you ever think that these would be good sources of energy?
Actually, coming from Brazil, we are great producers of biofuels. So we produce biofuels from corn and also from sugar. So there is a lot of work that shows that it's possible, it's feasible to extract fuel from these plants. But this implementation with these typical plants from the Philippines is really something really local, and the project is showing that it's really feasible.
Right, because before, and everybody, of course, worldwide knows Jatropha, right? Mm-hmm. And that was one of the more common sources, they said, of biofuel. But now, I mean, mango. I mean, who would have thought mango could actually fuel your car, right? And make it smell good too.
Yes.
And then another thing that I was reading on the list, was it, if I pronounce it correctly, piezoelectricity.
Yeah.
Yes.
Which is actually converting motion into electricity, right?
Yes.
Is that an original idea, Matt?
The idea is not original, but What the students are trying to prove, they're trying to compare a lot of different setups using room and walking motion.
Yeah.
So every time you are walking, you're producing energy. So they have a lot of different setups, and they're trying to compare which one is the best for in producing energy and charging a battery that may in the future charge your own phone or your own portable device.
Right. So just basically, it's moving an object. It's creating some kind of kinetic energy, right?
Yeah.
It's sort of like winding your watch when you're moving it.
Yeah.
And I also remember, because I think in other countries now, they're experimenting with using the vibration from the roads when the vehicles pass by and actually converting that into electricity.
That's actually, there is a project in Project Tuklas that it's trying to build a new version of it.
I see. Okay. So they're actually picking up ideas that are also being tried in other countries right now. Now, when you choose all of these entries, is there a final process of elimination?
Yes. Yeah. So, of course, after the local high school competition, we had the preliminary competition in which we selected the top three teams per each area cluster to move on to the final competition. And then from the final competition, we'll be selecting the top three teams to win our cash prizes.
Okay. As they move on from one stage of the competition to the next, do they have to make refinements to the project submissions that they've given?
Yes, so right after the local high school competition, they are already asked to execute their projects to the preliminary competition. And after the preliminary competition, we ask them to refine it even further for the final competition.
Okay, so when you choose, you're mentoring them, right? But when you choose someone to make it to the final stage of the competition, what kind of standards or what kind of base parameters do you use?
Actually, we're working in the basis that we're using, one, the feasibility of the project, because there's a lot of new ideas, but we really try to take projects that are really feasible to be converted in real prototypes, and then also the innovation, the scientific thought of the students, and how is their approach to the project and what they're proposing.
But I have to ask you, Rita and Matt, because reading through some of the projects, many of them seem to actually have already been used in other countries or tried in other countries. So is there like a level of originality that you still have to look out for?
In science, we have this belief that there is no eureka, there is no breakthrough innovation in the market.
You haven't spoken to Steve Jobs yet.
No, let me finish. But every breakthrough, every innovation that comes to the market, behind it, there is a lot of countless hours of work and research and prototyping and testing. So even if the ideas that their students are using are not so original, it's very important to have especially young people working on this project. And we believe that if they keep testing and trying and getting feedback and trying to make it better in the future, these ideas can be used to power up and really help to the future of energy.
Definitely. I mean, coming from Brazil, are there any out of the project proposals or project submissions you see that are already being applied in your own country, aside from the biofuel?
From the projects, there is some studies in another topics, another subjects that are already in Project Tuklas, but I think the main subject that's explored in Brazil right now are the biofuels.
Biofuels, yeah. Big thing. Actually, out of the total number of submissions, 78, right? Most of them are concentrated on using a specific type of, say, energy. Is it mostly plants? Because piezoelectricity doesn't involve any organic thing or plants, right? Mm-hmm. So it's mostly concentrated on using plants or fruits.
Yes.
Right.
So the background, when I was reading through the project proposals with the students, most really use biodiesels as their topic because it's available, readily available here in the Philippines.
Yeah.
So that was their main factor. And we believe in the project that it is important that whatever the source of energy that they will be getting from, that it is readily available.
And sustainable.
And sustainable.
Something that you can actually keep reproducing without necessarily running out of. So when they finally get to the final stage of the competition, they'll win a prize. You say they'll be funded.
When you reach the final competition, they are actually already eligible for the scholarship. So this is a 5-year scholarship to any ERDT university of an ERDT credited.
Okay, and you have to mention what ERDT means, which is a
engineering research and development.
It's a consortium of universities that actually pull together their talent for engineering research, right?
Yes.
Okay, so Ateneo's part of it, UP.
UP, UP de la Man, UP Los Baños, mm-hmm. as well as La Salle.
Okay.
And
so they can get a scholarship to any of those universities?
With
do they go to Brazil for a scholarship?
No, sadly. Okay. Only here, of course.
Too bad, girls, you don't get to do it after school.
Of course, we wanted them to stay here in the Philippines, so
of course.
An ERDT university in the Philippines.
Fantastic, fantastic. So, what stage are we now in the competition?
We are heading to the final competition this February 16.
So February 16, we'll be knowing now which, how many?
The top three teams.
Top three, right, the top three teams. So no matter how many members there are in the teams, they all get scholarships.
Yes. Yeah.
So if there are five members in the team, five scholarships.
Yes.
Even if they want to go to different universities.
Yes. And so as long as they, of course, pass an ERDT university.
And eventually you wind up working for?
Shell maybe, or Patron, or
Shell maybe,
or anything. Hopefully for Isaac also.
Yeah, for Isaac as
hopefully
well.
Also with Isaac. All right. Well, interesting because which means that in the next 5 or 6 years we'll be seeing the winners of Project Tuklas graduating from their courses, and they'll be the future engineers. But who knows? In 5 to 6 years, maybe we won't be on this planet, and we'll need engineers on Mars. All right, Rita Galvez from ISEC, UP, is that right? And Mateus, we called him Matt Damiao, international mentor of Project Tuklas. Thank you, both of you, for coming over.
Thank you very much.
And as I was saying, and over the last year, the gadget arena has been overshadowed by Apple and Android operating systems, but another OS has quietly emerged. Yes, it's the Windows Phone. HTC reinvented their flagship handsets using Windows to cater to techies who want a genuine alternative to Apple and Android.
With the unique color scheme and the seamless look, the HTC 8X boasts a Jelly Bean operating system and a dual-core processor rated at 1.5 GHz. Its 8-megapixel camera can take 80% wider angles. This means you can fit in every face in a group shot, including the surrounding scenery.
The bigger one, of course, you get, like I mentioned, 8-megapixel camera. You get the Gorilla Glass display, HD quality screens. You also have, like I said, the front camera, that's a wider shot. And of course, if you know the Windows 8 operating system, it has a lot of capability to tailor fit your screens to what you want.
The 8X also has live tiles that can be resized and pinned to the user's liking. And there's an unlimited number of tiles that you can set for a page. Meantime, its little brother, the 8S, is the more affordable version.
You can enjoy the Windows 8 operating system in a smaller and cheaper or more affordable price. Megapixel is a bit lower, the memory is also slightly lower, and of course the packaging is smaller.
HTC's One X Plus model is a beefed up edition of the HTC One X. It may be thin, but its polycarbonate body can withstand a 3-foot drop. It runs on quad core that clocks in at 1.7 GHz.
We added a stronger battery, we added a better screen, Gorilla Glass 2 screen. The memory of this phone is really big. It has a 64 gig memory and you have a 25 gig Dropbox.
And for extreme music lovers on the go, these phones at HTC's Gadget Lab is adapting the Beats audio technology, allowing users to boost the bass line and improve the quality of the audio on the handset.
All our phones have a Beats audio chip inside and amplifier. So compared to the rest of the phones out there, we have our own powerful and clear set of ways to listen to music and listen to any sound.
And not to be left out, the Kids Corner, a special menu for children so they can use your phone without destroying your personal files. Parents can customize games, videos, music, and application through this kid-proofing feature.
You can have your kid play with the specified menu that you want to, like games or any videos or movies. So your kid cannot accidentally go into your account and buy stuff or delete stuff or reply to your boss to email bad stuff.
And thank you for joining us. I'm Tony Velasquez. You can join me again next week when we again examine the present and look ahead to the future perfect of Philippine tech.